Hello, and welcome to our second annual Story Café celebrating Black History Month. My name is Maria, and I will be your host tonight. I'd like to begin by asking Chantal to do a land recognition and perform a traditional welcome song. Chantal?
Thank you so much, Maria. Tansé, Oki, bonjour, hello. My name is Chantal Chagnon. I am Cree, Anishinaabe, and Métis from Muskeg Lake Cree Nation in Saskatchewan, which is in Treaty 6 territory. But tonight we're coming from you in Treaty 7 territory. This was better known as Mulkinstis, which means elbow in Blackfoot. It's where the Bow River and the Elbow River come together in Calgary. It's a confluence, and it brings people together to share their stories, their teachings, their community, and just bring people together in a good way. And so, I'd like to acknowledge the Blackfoot of Siksika, Kainai, and Pagani, the Sarsi Dene from Tsutsuna, and the Stoney Nakoda from Morley, which includes Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Wesley First Nations. We're also walking in the footsteps of Métis Region 3, which is why I proudly wear my Métis sash, to act as that bridge between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people. When we acknowledge the land, we're acknowledging far more than that. We're acknowledging the history here. The stories that are steeped into this land, the very stories that bring us all together. We honor everyone within the circle. And to bring everyone together, I'd like to share with you the Cree welcome song. Traditionally, when we sing songs, we sing in rounds of four, to honor the four directions of the medicine wheel. But this song is a little bit different. We actually sing it in rounds of three, and that's to keep the circle open and welcoming so everyone completes the circle today. Because in a circle, we're all connected. There's no beginning, there's no end, no one is greater or less than anyone else in the circle, just like in the hoop of life. So it teaches us to honor each other for those differences. Because if we were all exactly the same, the world would be incredibly boring and nothing would ever get done. So we need those differences to make our community strong and our stories being shared. It really honors that connection that we have with each other. Mia Sin is from the Natahau family from Sturgeon Lake Cree Nation, and so I honor that family for keeping the song and the stories behind it alive, because for so many generations we weren't able to share our songs or our stories, and so it's a gift to be able to share them in a good way, because that was truly the meaning of the treaty, to come together, to share, and build community together for all of our future generations. Mia Sin, which is the Cree welcome song, not only means welcome, it also means beautiful. Mia sin, mia sin, ha se mina, ha se mina, e petagute. Wagomagan Hota Homa Kita Skino Miasin Miasin Hasemina Semina e petagote iwagomagan hota homa kita skino miasin miasin hasemina hasemina e petagote iwagomagan hota Homa kita skino. Hi, hi, and welcome to the circle tonight. Chimagwich, thank you. Back to Maria.
Thank you so much, Chantal, for that gracious welcome and for inviting us to tell our stories and have our concert on Treaty 7 territory. This past year has been one of turmoil and political strife, and of course, this terrible pandemic that has assailed us. And so I think that now more than ever, it's important to have events such as this, where we can come together as different peoples, but be able to share our stories and our cultures with each other. For those of you who are tuning in for the first time and have never heard of Storytelling Alberta, we are a charitable organization, a nonprofit charitable organization that has been around in Alberta since 1982. And our mandate is to promote the art of oral storytelling. And we do that with events such as this, storytelling, story cafes, as well as tell-arounds, where we get together in a circle and everyone gets an opportunity to tell a story. And the stories can be anything. They can be personal stories, they can be folk tales, they can be original stories that you have written. And so this is something that that Storytelling Alberta is very proud of, to be able to get together and tell stories wherever we can. Now, what I would like to do now is to say thank you to our sponsors who have been so great, so kind to us by supporting us financially. And first, I would like to say a big, huge thank you to TD Bank Group for their financial support. This is the second year that they have sponsored us, and we are very, very grateful. I'd also like to say thanks to the Alberta Foundation for the Arts for their support as well. And to our media sponsors who have jumped in to help to promote our event. So that's Global Calgary, Q107, and Country 105. And of course, I also want to thank Storytelling Alberta and the many volunteers who have helped me to be able to put this concert on, and just very grateful to everyone. So the theme for tonight's performance is, for tonight's concert, is the Black Experience, Journeys of a People. And we have a delightful group of storytellers tonight to entertain you and to regale you with all sorts of stories and music and poetry. We may not be able to get together in person, but the magic of storytelling is that the magic lies in the cross section between the storyteller, the story, and the listener. And we have all of those elements here tonight. And so let the magic begin. Our first storyteller is Norma Lewis. And her story is going to be a journey through her childhood and adulthood here in Calgary as a first generation Canadian. And I'll tell you a little bit about Norma. She's a very interesting person. She's a performing artist, 20 years with ACTRA. She has, and she is a co-founder of Ocho Rojo, a Calgary theater company that has been, I guess you have been acting with them for more than 15 years. She has traveled with the group throughout North America and worldwide, and has done extensive work in storytelling through voice, mask work, and dance. Her story tonight is called, "But What Am I?" Norma?
How could she abandon me, her only daughter? My mother left me standing alone in the Calgary airport. Okay, maybe I was 32 years old, so maybe not abandoned. But after 34 years of living, working, and single-handedly raising her three children, my mother packed her bags and a 32-foot trailer and went home. Home. As if she'd spent the last 34 years floating in space. How could she live in Canada for so long and still feel like somewhere else was home? Rosalind Jennifer Lewis was born in 1947 on the Caribbean island of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, an island so small you might have trouble finding it on a map. She spent the first 31 years of her life there with a huge family, 9 other siblings, aunties and uncles, countless cousins, nieces and nephews. She grew up much of her life in a tiny one-room tin house, raising her younger siblings, and the chores of feeding the goats and the chickens and fetching the water for the house, well, that would take up most of her mornings. And after walking miles to school and back, she would struggle to do her homework by kerosene lamp at night. And what may have seemed like an impoverished life, my mother did not feel limited, not by her surroundings. She had dreams and she had hopes for more. So when she started to have a family of her own, and the prospects came up for her to work as a nurse anywhere in the Commonwealth, my mother packed our bags and we flew over 6,000 kilometers, arriving in Calgary, Alberta. I was born about a year later. I was the firstborn Canadian of my family. My brothers used to tease me, "You're a Canadian." Like that was a bad thing. Yes, I would never be a true Vincentian, even though I did have my citizenship. My first memories of St. Vincent, well, they're not really memories at all. They're photographs, pictures of a little girl, me, very unhappy at the Barbados airport and crying my eyes out on an airplane. There were all these pictures of my little baby face and other baby faces. And I would ask my mom again and again, "Which cousin is that? Is that Granny? Whose house are we at? Is that you?" It was an island of mystery to me. I had this huge family living somewhere far away that I had only heard stories about. I might as well have been living on another planet to grasp the difference between here and there. It was a whole landscape of people and places I just couldn't understand. It wasn't until I was 8 years old when I finally experienced St. Vincent with eyes and ears. I could really appreciate the sounds and the smells and the tastes of it all. I had made up so many stories about the people in the pictures that by the time I got there, I wondered why they didn't all know me and recognize me, especially my cousin Kendra. We had so many photos together as babies that I assume she must be my best baby sister, cousin, friend. She looked at me like I was a crazy person as I came running up to her with my excited grin and I said, "We're best friends, and we're probably even sisters." Yeah, I was a little crazy. But eventually, I drew her into the story of us, the one I made up, and we became inseparable. She became my connection to that world, my Vincentian connection, my stamp of authenticity. Now, I too had real memories of this place my mom called home. Not long after I was born, we had moved from Calgary to Edson, Alberta, and lived there for almost 10 years. Small towns are just one giant playground for most kids. and I was a happy, playful child. I loved school, and my teachers adored me. I could outread anyone in my class, and I was a bit of a math nerd. Edson was a place where you could really be a kid. Outside of school, my life was running through the forest, hoping I wouldn't see a bear, or hiding in the meadow, trying to hide in the long grass. We would ride our bikes in the trailer parks and spend our days spying in people's windows and stealing candy from the local convenience stores. Just be home before dark. Yeah. The small town fairy tale, it was true, at least for me. I didn't seem to notice that we were the only Black family in town. And it didn't really bother me, unless somebody brought it up in some strange way. I would be busy having fun, running around on the playground or going tobogganing, and some kid would call me a nigger. And I would say, "I know you are, but what am I?" I didn't know what nigger meant. My mother would say, "Don't bother with people who talk foolishness. Just ignore them." Everything was simple for my mom. No need to make a fuss. So when I got the news that we were moving from Edson and going back to Calgary, I was devastated. My parents had divorced years earlier, and now some of my relatives had moved from St. Vincent to Calgary, and my mother thought she could use the support. So when the school year ended, we packed up the car and we drove to Calgary. Yeah, that was a culture shock. I mean, where did all these ethnicities come from? We had moved into the more culturally diverse area of Calgary, and so we were surrounded by Hispanic and Indian and Chinese, Filipino, and other Caribbean families. And then there was my now extended family. Parties, music, laughter, food, dominoes. It was a far cry from our quiet little apartment in Edson. Suddenly, I couldn't find a place to be alone and read a book. Someone was always teasing me and asking me questions I didn't understand. It was fun, but it wasn't Edson. Living with my relatives didn't last for long. My mother must have felt like she had been teleported back to that tiny tin house, and her whole family was now sardined inside. And she was not having it. She wanted a house of her own. So one job wasn't enough. So she got two jobs, and sometimes three. And she started going from place to place for work, and we would see less and less of her each day. It was hard growing up without her around. But it made us courageous and precariously independent. I can still remember in my teen and preteen years, just riding the C train and the bus, going from Northeast Calgary to Southeast to downtown. And well, now coming home after dark was just the norm. Goodbye, small town fairy tale. Calgary became the place where my mother went to work. My brothers and I, we didn't grow closer. We didn't share some sacred bond born out of shared tragedy. We just went out and forged our own lives. As we grew older, the identity of which Caribbean island we came from became less important. We were all just trying to figure out where do we belong in this kaleidoscope of nations and people. I struggled with understanding the Black identity in Canada, and what that meant for me. High school, that was a critical part of the journey. I went to a high school that had a larger Black population for Calgary standards. The kids there were usually from the Caribbean. Some of them were born here, or, well, it didn't really matter where they were from. If you were Black, you should be hanging out with them. And I wasn't. They would always be congregated around the same area, and I would often pass them by as I was entering the school. It would remind me of when I lived with my mom's relatives, you know, music, laughter, loud talking, as if some party is going on. And I would be walking down the hall, and as I came into view, everyone would fall silent. And they would watch me until I was out of sight. I didn't know what they thought of me, but I would say to myself, I know you are, but what am I? I was hanging out with the drama crew. My friends were geeks, nerds, weirdos. I was still that happy, playful girl from Edson, Alberta, just enjoying this new playground of my life in theater. I found a new world on the stage, a place where I could explore living lives I had never imagined. Like my mother, I didn't feel limited by my surroundings. I didn't want to be shaped by other people's stories. I loved every aspect of my heritage, the music, the culture, the food, the language, and I didn't want to change it. I wanted to take it with me. I was born out of the beautiful, colorful spirit of St. Vincent into this collage we call Canada, and it opened up doors to every corner of the earth. And I wanted to take advantage of it. I had journeys and adventures my mother could only have dreamed of. I spent 6 months in Australia, a weekend in New Zealand. I learned to detest the Los Angeles airport. And I will never forget my time in Brooklyn, New York. Now I was riding trains and gondolas in Switzerland and Italy and France instead of the Calgary transit system. I went from being a high school drama geek to performing on stages for thousands all across Canada and the United States in cities as like Victoria, Vancouver, Toronto, Jacksonville, Florida. Eventually, we were doing shows in other parts of the world. Prague, Stockholm, Taipei, London. Oh, I would wake up in a new city and wonder, how did I get here? I was living a life I never would have even thought that I could live. But somebody dreamed. My mother. So that night, when I was standing alone in the Calgary airport waving goodbye, I was filled with all the rush of emotions, and I realized that my mother had always intended to go home. But I will never forget the words she once spoke to me when she came to visit me in Australia. We were standing at the bottom of Frenchman's Peak, and my mother was afraid that she wasn't going to be able to make the climb. She wasn't wearing the right shoes and she could slip and fall. So we went ahead without her. And then I heard her call and ask us to wait. So as she climbed up and she took my hand, she said, "I didn't come all this way so I could stand at the bottom of the mountain." I guess not. Those words, they told me everything about who I am, about where I come from. So I just want to say thank you, Mom, for stepping into the unknown, for sacrificing your time and your energy and your youth to climb this slippery slope. Thank you for instilling in me a courageous spirit to not only survive, but to thrive, to prosper, to grow, to develop vigorously and flourish. Thank you for making the journey, for coming all this way. Have a safe flight home, Mom. I hope you enjoyed the climb. Thank you.
Unmute myself, sorry. Thank you so much, Norma, for that beautiful story. I started tearing up and I can't because I'm supposed to talk. It's just absolutely a beautiful, beautiful story. Okay, well, from that we go to our next performer, who is Doreen Vanderstoop. And Doreen plays guitar. She performs oral stories of all kinds to all sorts of audiences. She's also a newly minted author. Her debut novel, Watershed, was published by Freehand Books in May of 2020. And I just happen to have a copy of her book here. And it's a remarkable story. Okay, so she is very pleased to be performing with us tonight. Doreen strongly believes that it is important to be an ally in the fight against racism and in promoting awareness and understanding between people of different cultures. And I should also mention that she is also our fearless leader. She's the president of Storytelling Alberta. And now I present Doreen Vanderstoop.
Thank you very much, Maria, for that very lovely introduction. It is such an honor for me that you asked me to be part of this concert this evening. As Maria said, with everything that's happened over this past year, it's more important than ever that we celebrate our diversity. As Maria also said, I consider myself an ally against discrimination. Now, countering systemic racism in places like government, the workplace, educational institutions can seem very daunting, and it might leave many of us to wonder, what can we do? But there is help available. So Chantel is posting in this program a link to the World Economic Forum website. And that gives amazing tips, really helpful tips on how to be an effective ally. Now, the other reason I'm thrilled to be here tonight is I love exploring the past through song. And of course, music is critically important if you are exploring Black history. So the first song I'd like to do tonight is called Bring Me Little Water, Sylvie. And it was written by Huddy Ledbetter, better known by his stage name of Lead Belly. Now, Lead Belly was born in 1888 on a plantation in Louisiana. And he grew up to be famous for playing the 12-string guitar. But he also played the accordion, the harmonica, the mandolin, the piano, and the violin. Amazingly talented man. So this song epitomizes the rural American South. The way that Lead Belly always explained it at his concerts, it's about his Uncle Bob and Aunt Sylvie. And Uncle Bob used to work in those fields with his mules during the hottest months of the year. And he would holler for Aunt Sylvie to bring him his cool restorative water. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while. Don't you hear me coming? Don't you hear me coming now? Don't you hear me coming? Every little once in a while. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while.
So I have the pleasure now of introducing our director, Maria Crooks. Maria is a Calgary storyteller, playwright, actor, and singer. She is interested in myths, legends, and folk tales from Africa and the Caribbean. She has participated in many, many storytelling events for audiences of all ages in English and in French. Several of her plays have been produced locally. Maria believes in the power of stories to transcend differences, instruct, and entertain. I give you the amazing Maria Crooks.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Doreen, for such a kind introduction. In keeping with our theme of the Black experience, journeys of a people, I have chosen to tell you three accounts about Canadian history that have to do with journeys. Many years ago in Africa, there was a little boy who lived with his extended family, his parents and his aunts and uncles and cousins and his friends. And I believe that, like most little boys of that age, he was a happy-go-lucky little boy. And then something terrible happened. When he was around the age of 6, he was kidnapped, taken away from his family, put on a great big boat that traveled across a huge ocean and took him to a place that was called New France and that we know today as Quebec. Now, I can only imagine how frightened and scared this little six-year-old boy would be. He knew no one. He didn't know who these people were. He couldn't speak their language. They couldn't understand what he was saying. But there he was in Canada, in Quebec. We know a few things about this boy. We know that when he got to Canada, he was sold to a French clerk for 50 écus, which apparently is the equivalent of 6 months of a skilled workman's pay. We know that this clerk renamed him because they couldn't understand him when he spoke. So they gave him a new name and his name became Olivier Lejeune. We know that he was eventually sold to another French man who owned an estate. And he went to work for this man as a slave and remained working on this estate for the rest of his life. Of course, he never went back home. His parents never saw him again. And we also know that when he was around 30 years of age, he died. What we know about Olivier Lejeune as well is that he was the first recorded slave to be brought to Canada. And that was in the year 1629. We tend to know a lot about slavery in the United States. We know this, all the stories that have been told about people traveling through the Underground Railroad to get to Canada for safe haven. But what is less known is that in Canada, slavery also existed. And that for 200 years, African men and women and indigenous men and women were bought and sold and traded and gifted and bequeathed for many years. Now, it's true that in Canada, in early Canada, before the arrival of the Europeans, slavery did exist. Indigenous people would enslave their prisoners. But the slavery under European lines were different. For one, it was more on racial line more than anything else, of course. And they tended to treat the slaves as if they were less than human. Now, it's been said that in Canada, slavery was not as cruel as it was in the United States. But I don't believe that, because these people were as exploited and as dehumanized as the ones in the US. And we know that because many of them attempted to run away, just like the ones in the United States who fled to try to come to Canada. A little known fact is that long before slaves in the United States fled across the border to freedom in Canada, Canadian slaves ran in the opposite direction. In the 18th century, they ran to the US, to states that had outlawed slavery. And so the desire to be free and to stop being treated as chattel was as strong as it would have been with other slaves in the United States. Now, slavery in Canada didn't end with a bang as it did in the US. In fact, it just, there were a number of acts that were passed, and so gradually slavery ended in Canada. And eventually when slavery was abolished in the entire British Empire, that's when Canadian slaves also became free. And that was in 1834, which was just 30 years prior to the United States abolishing slavery in their country. The next story I am going to tell you is about a community in northern Alberta that flourished for the first half of the 20th century. And that community was called Amber Valley. It was a community of Black settlers who came across the border to Canada early in the 20th century, in answer to Canada's campaign to entice Americans to come north to settle our prairies. By 1909, there were about 300 people living in Amber Valley. and which was about, it's located about 170 kilometers north of Edmonton. And at the time it was called Pine Creek and then renamed Amber Valley. Now, the flow of Black settlers unfortunately ceased shortly after these first set of settlers arrived. And that is because Canada became, well, the Canadian government became frightened or alarmed at seeing this influx of Black settlers arriving here and began to put roadblocks in their way to stop them from coming. And so eventually that wave of Black settlers stopped. Now the community flourished for a number of years. There was a school, a post office, a baseball team that became quite well known in Northern Alberta and traveled all over playing white baseball teams. And this during a time when in the United States, Black baseball teams were not allowed to play white players. And that was happening here in Canada, where they were acknowledged and accepted and was recognized as being, well, just a pretty good team by all accounts. After the Second World War, the community began to decline. The younger people moved away to large cities such as Edmonton and Calgary. And then the seniors, the older people, began to die and the land was sold off. And now that community is no longer an active community. All that remains is a small museum with information about those first Black settlers to our province. But the descendants of those settlers are still here, and some of them have made a name for themselves. For example, Oliver Bowen, who became a civil engineer, was the designer of the Calgary LRT system. And he also designed many of our arterial roads. And Violet King, another descendant, became the first Black lawyer in Canada. The next story that has to do with journeys and Canadian history is a story to do with the sleeping car porters of Canada. There was a time in Canada when the one of the primary modes of travel was by rail. And the sleeping car was a convenient way for people who needed to travel overnight. The Pullman car was designed by George Pullman in 1865. And was used first in the US and then introduced to Canada. The Pullman cars were just luxurious affairs by all accounts. They had chandeliers and silk curtains and walnut paneling. And the service on these cars was modeled on slave era servitude. All the porters were Black. Their pay was very low. In fact, they had to depend on tips in order to make a living. And often they faced racial taunts. In fact, they were not even given the dignity of being addressed by their proper names. They were all called George after the founder of the sleeping car, George Pullman. Of course, this was very demeaning and the porters resented it. And one of them, Stanley Grizzle, in later life, wrote a book which he entitled, My Name is Not George. Now, the work of the sleeping car porter was very taxing. Their duties included things such as, of course, carrying the luggage of the passengers, but also pressing their clothes, shining their shoes, cleaning and emptying spittoons, and serving food and drink. And of course, one of their duties, one of their very important duties, was that they had to ensure that the passenger did not miss their station. If they did, they would be dismissed to the very serious, very, very serious offense. But this was the only job, or one of the very few jobs, that Black men in that era in Canada could obtain. And the employers knew this. And so they exploited them and treated them very badly. They had no opportunities for promotion, even though many of these men were highly educated. Because they were Black, they were not permitted to be members of the railway union, the railway employees union. And so in 1917, they created their own union, the Order of Sleeping Car Porters. And for years, they had to fight and struggle for better working conditions, for promotions, and for increase in pay. And it was only in 1954 that one porter was eventually hired as a conductor. But all of this struggle taught these men how to organize. And so they decided to take on Canada's discriminatory immigration laws. And so in 1954, a delegation of porters and former porters, led by Stanley Grizzle, he of the book, My Name is Not George, and another gentleman, Donald Moore, who had been a porter himself, and accompanied by allies from the Jewish community, arrived in Ottawa and presented a brief to the Minister of Immigration, pointing out the discriminatory laws that prevented people of color, Black people and people of other ethnic groups who were not white, to be allowed to come into Canada. And this brief, it was a landmark brief, and it drew a lot of attention to it. And eventually, as we know, Canada's immigration laws have been relaxed, and it's due in part to the pioneering work of these men, Stanley Grizzle, Donald Moore, and the porters. There are so many stories that I could tell about Black history. When I started reading, I almost became overwhelmed by so many stories. But I'll leave them for another time. I have also put, there are links posted below on these stories and many others for those of you who might be interested in knowing more. Thank you so much for listening. And now we are going to have Doreen again, I believe. And Doreen is going to tell us a remarkable story about a woman from the southern US who herself led a very interesting life and found fame and fortune later on in her life. Doreen? Can you hear me?
Elizabeth Cotton. Amazing woman that she was. I have the pleasure of telling you about her tonight. So Elizabeth Cotton was born in North Carolina to a poor family. Her grandmother had survived slavery, and well, Elizabeth was made of the same bone-deep strength that would portend her becoming a self-made woman, although it would take some years for that to happen. But she was a spirited soul from the very beginning, so much so she even named herself. As Elizabeth told it, it happened at school, her first day of school, and the teacher was asking all the children their names and calling roll. But the thing was, is Elizabeth hadn't been named by her parents. They just called her Sis. So when the teacher came around to Elizabeth and she said, now, little Sis, don't you have a name? What is it? And Elizabeth said, Elizabeth. She doesn't know where she found that, but she said it. The teacher wrote it down, and that was her name ever after. When she was 7 years old, she took up her brother's banjo. Now, the way she put it, ain't no one had no peace in that house after that. But when any of the family members complained about her playing, her mother would say, she's my baby. You let her do what she wants. She ain't doing nothing wrong. But the family struggled. The family struggled against poverty and against racial exploitation. Elizabeth would tell the story about her father having to bury the meat. If he didn't bury it, white people would come and take it. She remembers her mother telling her father frequently, bury the meat, I hear the horse's feet. So when Elizabeth was 12, in order to help out the family, well, she got a job as a domestic. And she earned 75 cents a month. But that gave the family enough extra money that after some time, they were able to buy Elizabeth a guitar. Now, being a lefty, she had always played her brother's banjo upside down. So she flipped over the right-handed banjo, played it without changing the strings. So when she started playing guitar, she ordered a right-handed guitar, and she flipped it over, kept the strings as they were, and that's what she began to play. So that meant that she developed her own absolutely unique style of finger picking, and that's what she did all her life. It's what she was known for. Her finger picking patterns and styles were legendary. Now, sometimes she would ask her brothers to teach her chords, and they'd say, nah, Elizabeth, you don't play it right. But of course she did. She had her own unique style. At the very tender age of 15, Elizabeth got married, which was not unusual for that time. But she began diligently working for the church, and that meant she all but gave up the guitar because the church considered it too worldly. Now flash forward many, many years to when Elizabeth is 60. And she gets a job with the voraciously musical Seeger family of Pete Seeger fame, that folk great. Well, one day Elizabeth picks up the guitar and starts to play and sing, and the family is astonished at her talent. It was Mike Seeger, Pete Seeger's half-brother, who began to play with Elizabeth, and in fact did her first recording, so her first album, in her very own home. In the late 50s and early 60s, Mike Seeger and Elizabeth Cotton began to tour together, venues large and small. They even played at the home of an ambitious young senator named John F. Kennedy. During the 60s, while she began to play with greats such as Muddy Waters and John Lee Hooker as part of the Great Folk Revival, and that is when she truly found her fame. She was able to leave poverty behind for good because now she had recording contracts and touring dates and awards to her name. She kept touring right up into her late 80s. And when she was in her late 80s, she was featured as one of 75 influential African-American women as part of a photo documentary project called I Dream a World, Amazing. At the age of 90, she won a Grammy. It was for her album, Elizabeth Cotton Live, in the category of ethnic and traditional recordings. Well, at the award ceremony, when she accepted the award, she said, "Thank you. I only wish I had my guitar and I'd play you all a song." Elizabeth Cotton passed away at the age of 94. But the song Freight Train takes us way back to 1903, when Elizabeth is 11 years old. Freight Train became her signature song throughout her life, and she wrote it at 11. She was inspired by the train tracks that ran very close to her house as she was growing up, because the trains on those tracks would lull her to sleep at night. Freight train, run so fast. Freight train, run so fast. Please don't tell what train I'm on. They won't know what route I've gone. When I'm dead and in my grave, no more good times ere I crave. Place a stone at my head and feet. Tell them all that I've gone to sleep. When I die, Lord, bury me deep. Down at the foot of Old Chestnut Street. So I can hear old number 9 as she goes rolling by. Freight train, run so fast. Freight train, run so fast. Please don't tell them what train I'm on. They won't know what route I've gone. They won't know what route I've gone. Thank you.
What a beautiful song. And you sing it and play it so well. Thank you, Doreen. And now we come to our final storyteller tonight, and that is Bertrand Bickerstaff. Bertrand was born in Sierra Leone and raised in Alberta, and has lived in the United Kingdom and the US. His most recent book of poetry was published last year by New West Publishing, and I happen to have a copy of his book here. I haven't had a chance to start reading it because it just was delivered a few days ago. Now, the other thing I want to tell you about this remarkable young man is that he was voted by CBC Radio or CBC Broadcasting Corporation as being among the 6 Black Canadian writers to watch in 2021. Tonight, Bertrand is going to read some of his poetry and talk about his inspiration for writing them. Oh, and I should also mention that he was interviewed on CBC by Sheila Rogers on her program, The Next Chapter. And I heard it, and it was a fabulous interview. And we have put a link to that interview at the bottom for you to listen to if you're interested. Bertrand?
Thank you so much, Maria, for that lovely introduction. Thank you. I also want to quickly thank Storytelling Alberta for having this event and showcasing wonderful Black art and Black talent. Maria, thank you so much for inviting me to do this. This is my second time doing it, and I'm really happy to be here joining you. Thanks for organizing all of this. But also, Chantel, thank you so much, too, for organizing things behind the scenes for us, as well as producing that incredible performance with the land acknowledgement. Thank you so much for that. And Doreen, I have to say that this is not the first time that we are sharing space, actually. So Doreen's novel, as you all heard, Watershed, was released roughly the same time as my collection of poems. And we have been reviewed in the same column together. And we have also been interviewed on a CJSW program called The Writer's Block this summer in the same show. So my segment and then her segment in the same show. So this is just the one more time in which we're sharing space. And it's only a joy to do that. And of course, thank you so much, Norma, for that amazing performance, that wonderful tribute to your mother, the sense of displacement and replacement and connecting with her is just fantastic. I have really enjoyed sitting here listening to all of these performances and from these wonderful performers. So it is a storytelling event, but I've been booked to read some poetry. So I guess we think of it as between the songs that we've heard and the words that we have listened to, poems lie somewhere between that. And I'll try to emphasize that by filling my poems with stories about why or how I came to write some of them. All right, so I'm going to be reading from The Response of Weeds now, and I have just a few poems to read to you because there's lots of story to tell you about them. The first poem that I'm going to read to you is called The Negro Speaks of Alberta. And this is a poem that was inspired by another poet who I deeply respect. His name is Langston Hughes. He is one of the founding figures of the Harlem Renaissance, the African-American literary and artistic movement that took place at the beginning of the 20th century in the 1920s. Some of you may have heard of Zora Neale Hurston and people like that, anyway. So he was the great poetic voice of this movement. And what a lot of people don't realize is, although this movement emerges from the city, it's the Harlem Renaissance, and it was a time in which many Black people were moving from the South and moving up to the North, and so creating these communities in cities like New York and Chicago. Although he is associated with the city, Langston Hughes was actually first, it was born, I almost said firstborn, as though he's had multiple births, but he was born in Joplin, Missouri, which is on the western side of Missouri, right smack in the middle of the American prairies, or as they call them, the plains. He also was raised by his grandmother in Kansas, and we definitely know we're in prairie territory there. So I find him to be inspirational in more than one way. Yes, he helped to create this Harlem Renaissance, this amazing artistic movement of Black people, but also he himself is a prairie boy. And so I found that a way to connect with him when I wrote my poems. Now, you may have heard of some of his poems because he's that famous, but the most famous one is the poem that is called The Negro Speaks of Rivers. And this is the poem that I am speaking to when I wrote my own, The Negro Speaks of Alberta. It's a very famous poem that begins with the lines, I've known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood and human veins. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. Wonderful poem in which you can hear that yearning for the African-American identity to reconcile itself to the African culture that it had been severed from. So in a similar way, I am kind of trying to reconcile myself to my denied Albertan identity, because as I will mention to you in an upcoming poem, if you are a person of color, certainly if you're Black and Canadian, you are often not viewed as a legitimate Canadian. And so growing up in Alberta, it was often my struggle to try to understand, well, what is my Albertan identity as a Black person? Langston Hughes allowed me a way into that. And so now I give you, not The Negro Speaks of Rivers, but The Negro Speaks of Alberta. Once he stood on the banks of the Bow, near the confluence of the Old Man, watching for the common effluence of the South Saskatchewan, the Red Deer, the Saskatchewan, and so on and on and on. I know these rivers that flow past me. I've peered over their banks, and I know you do not see me. Once he stood on the banks of this twisted river, released a gleaming arc of relief into its heart. For an untroubled while, their waters flowed together and emptied together out of a distant, unsuspecting mouth. I know these rivers that flow through me. I've peered into their hearts, and still you do not see me. That is The Negro Speaks of Alberta, inspired by Langston Hughes. The next poem that I would like to read to you is a poem that was developed from one of my homelands. So I have several homelands. I was born in Sierra Leone, as Maria pointed out, but I grew up here in Alberta. And since then, I've lived in the UK, I lived in London, and I also lived in the US. I lived in Michigan in the US. And all of these places are my homelands for diverse reasons. I mean, when I was in London, my son was born when I was in London. He spent his early childhood there. And then when we moved to the UK, he spent half of his schooling there. And so you connect with people and you grow roots there. But we would often come back to Alberta on visits, and I was always struck by the singular difference between the landscape there and here, and the different ways in which I felt myself belonging to both of those places, and at the same time not belonging to both of those places. This is a poem that connects to or accesses a funny Michigan tradition. So if you look at the map of Michigan, you may or may not notice that Michigan looks like a mitten. It's kind of shaped like that. And this has become Michigan's identity. They call themselves the Mitten State. And it's so ingrained into their thinking that if you meet somebody for the first time and they ask you, oh, you know, where are you from? What part of Michigan are you from? They'll hold up their hand just like this, their right hand, and they'll point to a place and they'll say, oh, I'm from here. They're like, oh, you're from that town. Yeah, that's right. So I lived in this part right here of Michigan, right along the Lake Michigan is right there. Underneath, we've got Ohio and then Indiana underneath there. And this is just a thing that they do there. And they don't find it funny at all. But me coming from somewhere else, I thought it was hilarious. But now I'm used to that sort of thing. So the mitten for me was very evocative of Canada, because obviously it's what you put on when you get cold in winter. But Michiganders, and that's what they call themselves, by the way, they're not Michiganians or Michigan people, they're Michiganders. And Michiganders see themselves as kind of pseudo-Canadians. They identify with Canada because they're one of the cold states in which you get these heavy winters. I found that very funny because they're nothing like Canadians. They even have a strange accent that you might find quite silly when you hear it. Sometimes I found it hard to even understand them, believe it or not, that thick Midwestern accent. But Michigan is my Michigan. It's my homeland in the US. And in the same way that Alberta is my homeland in Canada, I thought that I would write a poem that tries to overlap and question these ways in which I belong and don't belong, and in the ways in which Michigan is like and unlike Canada and Alberta. So this poem is called Grown in Alberta. In Michigan, they will point to a spot on the palm of their right hand when you ask, where are you from? For Michiganders, the hand is a simulacrum for substitute belonging. First came the hand, then the map, then the hand again. The map's handsome substitute. But first came the cold, and then the mitten, the map's handsome substitute. On the Canadian prairies, The cold is your constant contender. The cold is always first. Once I dreamed of an empty grain elevator, sheathed in brittle ice. I wanted to get inside, but each time I chipped at its door, I felt an enervating pang in the hollow of my abdomen. I wanted to get outside, but each time I chipped at its door, I saw a glinting mirrored surface magnifying my actions. Everything went cold, my breath, undusted diamonds suspended before me. A landscape was hinted in its spaces. I would have placed my hand up against it, the curl of my fingers settling along the foothills. But at times like these, you can't help thinking about those prototype fools in stories who bore the substitute cold to their tongues. The very wording of my verisimilitude belonging. And Canada, you would not believe how often a Michigander never asked me, where are you from? So that's grown in Alberta, the yes and no of my belonging to these two different places. I think I have time for two more poems. And so this next one I'm going to read to you is one that Maria doesn't realize it, but she kind of requested this from me. So she spoke so enthusiastically about it that I thought, okay, well, I guess I should read this one, okay? And it's called King Kong on the Prairies. And this poem is a poem that deals directly with racism, for me, anyway. I don't explicitly talk about it in the poem, but in working through racism, this poem came out. And one of the nasty occurrences that what happened to me when I was younger is people making monkey noises at you when you're young. You'd be shocked at how these things happen. Happened all the time in the 70s. It still happens though, because this idea of connecting Black people to something that's subhuman pervades even in professional sports. If you're a soccer fan like I am, you know that in the UK, they have had to instigate a rule in which the game will stop if fans are jeering Black players by making monkey noises and things like that. So it happened in the 70s and it's still happening today, unfortunately. The idea of this Blackness and subhumanness has historical roots. Africans were considered subhuman, and we've heard varieties of that even tonight through those lovely histories that Maria gave us. And King Kong himself is an example of that kind of figuring. The movie, which came out in 1933, plays on this connection. And that's why the most famous scene is of this large subhuman creature stealing a beautiful blonde woman and going up to the top of a building where now this beautiful blonde woman has to be rescued. This beautiful blonde woman, ladies and gentlemen, was played by an actress named Faye Ray, who happens to have been from Cardston, Alberta. I thought this was a lovely connection to the King Kong movie. But if you're not convinced about the connection between subhumanness and King Kong, I will tell you there's a scene in the movie of King Kong in which they go to capture this giant ape from the Pacific island that he's from. So they travel out to the middle of the Pacific to get him. And the native islanders on this Pacific island are quite clearly and distinctly African. So the notion that King Kong comes from some sort of Africanness, or that Africanness is connected to some sort of subhumanity, is definitely connected in this particular film. So I wanted to revisit this connection in this poem, but I wanted to return it to my prairie landscape. And I wanted to try to present a more sympathetic view of this monstrous King Kong subhuman figure. So this is called King Kong on the Prairies. We've stopped paying him any mind, with nothing of any consequence to climb. What's the point, really? Maybe we should have let him live. shot through the heart with an elephant gun we brought with us when we came here. The mound of his carcass is the tallest obstacle between here and Saskatchewan. Before we shot him, we had given him a cowboy hat, an original white Russian shumiatcher that Smith built, later built. It doesn't quite look like a fleck of white pus from a dimpled blackhead from this distance. I remember the king on his island. Back then, I was just one of the savages hired to reinforce the symbolism of his unfettered nature for your cameras. I was good at my job. It's funny to think that we understood our limits too well back then, and that now his serenity adds a special something to this unbroken landscape. That's King Kong on the prairies. I think I have time for one more now. Okay, so I am going to skip to my last poem now. And I want to return us to the theme of music that we have been hearing all evening long. And my last figure is Big Miller. Big Miller, of course, was an iconic jazz and blues performer, originally from Kansas, though. He was raised in the big boom of the Kansas jazz scene. And I can't remember the small town he came from. It's south of Wichita. I forget what it's called. But he did, as a teenager, move up to Kansas City and joined Jay McShann and these other amazing big band leaders of that period in the 30s and the 40s. Well, eventually, as a musician, he finds his way up to Canada on tour. He played trombone and the double bass, but was most known for singing. And he had an amazing, booming blues voice. He actually helped to create something of a scene in Canada when he came, because he had all these jazz connections from Kansas and the rest of the US. And he was instrumental in helping to start the Edmonton Jazz Festival, which is still running today. I see him as a symbol of a history that I didn't actually live, but I learned about it afterwards. And I like to think of him as our Oscar Peterson here in Alberta. So here's a short poem. It's called Alberta Presents Big Miller. I never saw Big Miller play. Here is his impression, though. One more silent invader who followed the well-worn away ancient cattle trail north, leaving invisible prints, following invisible prints. One more historical haint, soothing the South with nothing but his bare hands and his giant Albertan presence. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I really appreciate you listening to these poems. Thank you. Sioux City, Iowa. Yes, that's right. He was born there, but he grew up in Kansas. That's right. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. I could listen to these poems for a long time, all evening. Thank you so much, Bertrand. It's so interesting, you know, you hear a poem and you think you understand it, but it makes it come more alive when the author is able to explain the meaning behind, or the inspiration behind the poem. So thank you again. Okay, well, we have come to the end, or almost the end, of our concert tonight. I once again want to thank all the storytellers for their lovely, lovely stories and the singing and the music. And of course, Ms. Chantal, Ms. IT herself, Ms. Technical Expert, because I'll let you know a secret. Without Chantal, this concert would not have happened, because yours truly knows nothing about putting things on YouTube or on Facebook or anything. So she has been just wonderful. Thank you so much. Once again, I want to thank our sponsors. First of all, TD Bank Group, for their generous support of us last year and this year again. And As well, I want to thank the Alberta Foundation for the Arts and our media sponsors, Global Calgary, Q107, and Country 105, and of course, Storytelling Alberta, and the wonderful volunteers who have done enormous work to help me to be able to produce this, put on this concert. So now that we have come to the end, I just wanted to mention a few things. The next story cafe will be in April, the last Wednesday of the month. So that will be the 28th, and information will be on our website with more information about it. Also, we have a survey that we would like to ask you to complete for us, to tell us what you thought of us tonight. And if you leave us your email addresses, you will be entered in a draw to win a wonderful prize of recorded stories. So once again, thank you so much for being part of this concert. And we're going to end tonight with a video that we're going to play for you. I think someone mentioned tonight jazz pianist Oscar Peterson. He's a Canadian icon. He wrote a piece of music called Hymn to Freedom. And he wrote this in 1962 at the time when there was a lot of turmoil, racial turmoil and concerns in the US and in Canada and all over the world. And now his music has been combined with this video, which shows the many people, many Black Canadians that have contributed to making Canada this great place to live in. And so I want to say good night, take care of yourselves, be safe, enjoy the video, and good night.